My name is Justin Walsh. I am Associate Professor of Art History and Archaeology here at Chapman University. And we're standing in the Guggenheim Gallery, which is our display space for exhibitions both of student work and also of professional artists. We have collaborative shows and we have single artist exhibitions, and we're here for the latter today. We're going to be looking at work that's on display by Roland Miller, and these were done in collaboration with the Italian astronaut Paolo Nespoli, who was on the International Space Station twice, and particularly in 2017, he and Roland collaborated to produce this extraordinary body of work, which has never been on display before, and which we're really thrilled to present because it is a great sign of the kinds of things that have been happening for 20 consecutive years on the International Space Station. November 2nd, which is just 3 weeks away, November 2nd, 2020, will mark 20 consecutive years of continuous habitation of this space station, which is the largest spacecraft that's ever been built, the most expensive building projects humans have ever created. And I just think it's an extraordinary document, these photographs that Roland and Paolo collaborated to create. So maybe I'll just let Roland introduce himself, and then I can talk a little bit about our connection.
Okay. Well, I'm Roland Miller. I'm a photographer. I've taught photography for 20 years and have been photographing the space program for over 30 years. I got involved with it because I taught at the college near the Kennedy Space Center and Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, and began documenting the deactivated and repurposed space launch complexes on Cape Canaveral, and then expanded that kind of across the country with other NASA facilities. I've done an extensive body of work on the space shuttle as well, and met an astronaut named Katie Coleman, who really liked my work and encouraged me to think of a way I could get my photographic approach and vision to the astronauts on board the International Space Station. And in doing that kind of process and coming up with a plan, Katie connected me with Paolo, and we came up with an idea to, basically I would send him photographs of existing imagery of the station, and he would recreate them on the station, and then I would process them back on Earth. And that's how we came up with this show. It also includes some images by Paolo that he took on his own, and some images I made of Earth-based facilities as well.
As I mentioned, I am an archaeologist here at Chapman, and the project that I'm working on at the moment, together with a collaborator in Australia, Dr. Alice Gorman, we are studying the International Space Station as an archaeological site, because one of the things that we've realized is that even though space agencies have been studying since 1961 the biological, physiological, psychological effects of long-duration spaceflight in order to make it possible for humans to do that better, they've never really looked at the social and cultural aspects in any detail. And archaeology is a great way to look at that. But unfortunately, we're not allowed to go to space. NASA actually prohibits archaeologists, anthropologists, social scientists of any kind from becoming astronauts. So, we decided we would use photographs as evidence because they've been collecting photographs, thousands, tens of thousands of photographs over that 20-year period. And we're getting those images from NASA. And you can actually see some of the examples of what we're talking about, how we can see the material culture, that is to say the objects and the built spaces that tell us about the social lives of the astronauts in some of the photographs, such as this one here, which shows the interior of, it looks like the Kibo module, the Japanese experimental module. And you can see all the different kinds of items from basically like a little mascot to a Japanese flag to mission patches and even writing about the installation of the module, like we were here, we did this. One great example that Paolo took that, thanks to Roland and Paolo, we're actually publishing in an article that's out for peer review right now, is this image right here, which shows some of the other display practices that the astronauts have and how they're taking spaces on the space station that are not meant for this, but they're kind of improvising because they want, you know, like you put stuff on your refrigerator door, they want to show things to each other. They want to have a way of marking places individually. So in this particular image, we have all the mission stickers from each of the missions that have happened up until the date that Paolo took this image, and up above, really extraordinary, essentially a makeshift memorial to deceased colleagues, deceased astronauts, including members of both the Columbia and the Challenger crews who perished in spaceflight. There's even, this is the most remarkable to me, there's a name tag, probably from somebody's office door at Johnson Space Center. So these photographs are extraordinary evidence, and you can see throughout this exhibition, and think about how what you're seeing is evidence for how humans are learning to live in a society and build a space culture. That's one of the things that makes me really excited, and this one of the ways that we connect.
Right. And I think the important thing about this is you have to remember that the space station is both our workplace and our home, and they're home for a long time. They can't go outside, they can't go down to the store. So it's really important, I think, from a psychological standpoint, to have some sort of semblance of personal space and personal items up in the modules, and this is one of those examples.
Yeah. Roland, do you want to take us over to some of the photos that you took here on Earth?
Sure. So I kind of accidentally started this project, though Paolo and I really did the photographs of the ISS in 2017. I started photographing modules before they were launched way back in 1998. And this is an example of that. And this image is one of the pressurized meeting adapters which connect the different modules together, and also typically it's where the spacecraft dock. And so it's a tunnel that narrows down. This would be the part, this end is a part that's attached to the standard module, and then some sort of docking mechanism would be at the other end. And those change over time depending on the spacecraft and what's going on. But this to me was a great reference to the painter Pete Mondrian because of the color scheme and the geometric shapes, and it was very evident to me that I was reacting to that as well. So as part of my work with this, I'm trying to document things, but I'm also trying to interpret them and bring in cultural aspects that relate to both the history and the significance of this facility.
Along this wall, we have various aspects of life on the space station. Roland, do you want to take us through
them? Let me explain a little bit about the project too here, because this is a good example. My goal in doing this work was to do something that wasn't being done by the astronauts. If you look at images from the space station, they're amazing. And far and away, the majority of those images are made looking out from the cupola or the other viewing ports that they have. And a lot of those landscapes are beautifully abstract. I would have loved to have done that, but it's really being, you know, covered by the astronauts. So
they all publish books with them.
Right. So I thought, well, what can I do that would be meaningful and useful that isn't being done? And it was to record the interior of the station. Most of the photographs being made on the station are of astronauts both doing experiments, just having general activities, eating, or the experiments themselves, or again, outside the window. So I thought if I could just photograph the interior itself, which also aligns with my history of documenting the facilities and the spacecraft rather than the people. But along with that, I didn't want to miss the opportunity to photograph from the most amazing window out of this world, which is the cupola. So you have a series of photographs here. And there are, in some of these, Paolo intentionally used a flash to light up the interior, because it's very dark, obviously, and balance it with the exterior light on the Earth. So that's kind of what this series is, as well as the original photograph we started out at.
Yeah, it's interesting because the crew members are all trained to take photographs. They receive training to take photographs. But the photographs that they're receiving training to take are just of a couple of different kinds of things. As you said, it's like beautiful photographs of Earth. It's photos that can be used to promote NASA public relations so that they can bring this to the public and make people think that, you know, human spaceflight is an awesome thing and we should be supporting it. So it serves those needs as well. Or it's documenting experiments.
Right.
And sometimes it's just these pictures where you just see a piece of equipment and nothing
else.
Right. And they're not super exciting. But they need to send them to the researchers to say, this is how we did the experiment.
Right. This is
what you're showing us here is the complete other side of what's going on.
Well, and one of the things you notice when you start looking at the station, there is stuff stored everywhere. This is actually the end cone of the of NO2, the forward end cone, which is now where the SpaceX docks, but at that point they weren't using it, so they just shoved a bunch of stuff. A lot of these were to be returned on the SpaceX flight to bring different materials, mostly probably experiments, back to Earth. Again, things stored pretty much everywhere, anywhere there's a space.
This one is actually Paolo's berth. This is his, like, his bedroom, which is the size of a telephone booth, which if anybody remembers what that is. But anyway, so it's about the size of a telephone booth, but wedged in literally all around it. And there are three other berths. There's one here, one facing, and one down below. They're like in a square pattern. And wedged in between all of them are these storage bags. This is how they live. Right. One of the things that we constantly are saying to each other, Alice and I, as we're looking at these images, is this is not an easy life. No. This is a very difficult life. They don't get to shower. They have to exercise 2 hours a day every day. They don't get to change their clothes very often. They're drinking their own urine. It's been regenerated back into water. They say yesterday's coffee tomorrow. This is how they live.
Paolo told an interesting story. On his two different sets of expeditions, he was on opposite walls. He said, so when he came up on the second trip, he'd come out of his berth and he'd go the right. He said, it took me about a week because when he'd go to the right, he was going one way, but when you're on the opposite wall, you're going the other way. So it took him a little while to get used to that. Yeah, so, you know, they don't have a lot of storage space up there because space is valuable. So they do use whatever they can.
And then, you know, here we have the scientific equipment that they're using to conduct all the experiments that they're doing. And in fact, these are mounted, you know, there's no up or down for
right.
them. So all four surfaces are being used for these. So, you know, we could be looking up or down or to either wall, and there's this stuff everywhere. It's pretty remarkable.
This is technically looking at a zenith or up. These two, this one is looking port, I believe, and this one is also looking forward, depending on the structure of the module. So yeah, I wanted to document a lot of these racks kind of very straightforwardly, just to give you an idea of what they're, and also compare the technology. They are, to some extent, modular. You can see that these, there's about two or three different size units that can go into these. This one
the units are actually the exact same dimensions as the white storage tanks.
Oh, okay.
It's all designed to be modular, and it's all based on the space shuttle's lockers in the mid deck.
Okay.
And that's how they were designed, so everything would fit into the shuttle.
I can tell now by looking at them there on the same side. This is actually the galley with the water dispenser unit and heaters and different things. So.
But that's how they cook.
Yeah. I have a number of more of these, but this set I like is something to display of it. This is a controller for the Dragon spacecraft that they can control. I believe there's enough cable they can go over to the cupola with it and direct it with that.
Okay, so moving on, here we have workspaces, right? So yes. We've got, this is interesting, we've got all the emergency manuals that are stored up in one corner of the U.S. Destiny Lab. We have a couple of workbenches. And do you want to talk about the misfit toys and stuff?
Yeah, so, I mean, I thought it was important to include this because they're living in an incredibly hazardous environment. You know, they're at risk of micrometeorites, decompressing, any kind of fire is terrible. They're constantly irradiated, you know, all kinds of damage to their bones and even their DNA, it looks like. So I thought it was important to acknowledge that in this picture. So there's two photographs here. This is their work desk where they meet every morning to discuss the schedule and what's going on. They have the schedule on the computer and there's other written schedules. And this is actually a work bench where they repair things. But in both of these, there's a little bag that's labeled Land of Misfit Toys. And so things that float by, somebody grabs, stick them in there. And even I even can see in some of the sequences of exposures, there'd be a little thing that would float past.
So this is a really interesting aspect of life in space that we don't think about. And this is really relying on the work of my colleague Alice, my co-investigator on the International Space Station Archaeological Project. You'll notice in these photos all these baggies, these little Ziploc baggies, and also all the Velcro. And that's necessary because when you let something go on the International Space Station, well, first of all, we know it's not going to fall because there's no gravity, but you think, oh, maybe it'll just stay there. It doesn't stay there. There's so much ventilation on the space station that things will just fly away. And so they need the Ziploc bags and they need the Velcro to stick things where it's going to stay. And Alice's term for this is that these bags are gravity subservients, that they stand in place of this thing that we're missing and that we're adapted for and that we're used to, that when we let go of something, it will fall down on the table or on the floor. Nope, it's going to go someplace else and you're not going to find it. And the objects that are in the Land of Misfit Toys bags are objects that almost certainly have been found probably up against a ventilation duct where they've been sucked by the air, because that's, so they just will tend in that direction. And they're constantly finding things, but they don't necessarily know what to go with. They have to figure that out. And I can tell you, because we have access to the inventory management system, the database that holds all of the objects that have ever been sent to the space station, they've sent 377,000 objects, and over 8,000 of them are missing. So almost 3% of the objects that they've sent to space, they don't know where they are, and it's like it's an enclosed environment. Where could they go? But they go. They disappear behind the racks. They're talking about because they pull things in and out, and they find things there. I believe the longest time that something got lost was 5 years before they found it again. So, yeah. These are unbelievable photographs, but they have a special story associated with them.
So, I didn't know about these photographs when I first met Paolo. And actually, a friend of mine told me this. He said, oh, Paolo, he's the one that took the photographs of Space Shuttle Endeavour docked at the ISS. I'm like, I didn't know there were any pictures of the shuttle. So the last space shuttle mission of Endeavour to the ISS, Paolo, they made special arrangements for him to photograph the station with the space shuttle docked at it. It's never been done before or since, and certainly won't be done now, obviously. And so he made these just amazing images of the space station. And there are actually about five different vehicles docked at the station at that time, so they call it the kind of the royal flush of spacecraft. And you know, it really shows you how beautiful it is. And interesting things you can see, these are the radiators that they cool the station with. One here has a big tear, big flap is torn back, and they don't know for sure what caused that. I read a bunch of the reports about it. Might have been some sort of expansion and contraction. Could have been a meteorite of some kind, but they don't know. Last I saw, they didn't really know for sure what caused it.
So some of these components are 30 years old.
Oh yeah.
Right? So the Russian module, in fact, the main Russian module, was built in the 1980s.
Right.
And they're planning to continue to use it until at least 2024, 2028, possibly 2030.
Yeah, the Russian segment, which is here, was going to be Mir 2. It was going to be its own space station. And then when the idea to have an international space station come up, they decided to join forces. Yeah. And by the way, we didn't photograph the Russian section of the station. It's not because it's not important, but because it was a complex project to get approved, and to add that in would have probably killed the whole thing. So
sure. It's one of the interesting aspects of this. It's an international project, and yet there are national spaces within this international project. And that's actually one of the things we're studying, is how international is it, how national is it?
They kiddingly refer to the adapter between the American station and the international part of the station and the Russian part of the station as Checkpoint Charlie from the Cold War. So.
So, why don't you tell us a little bit about
these images? So, in documenting these, a lot of these images are very symmetric because the station is very symmetric, and it just seemed like it was important. And this is a shot taken with the lights turned dark. I'd say it was night, but in reality, they go through, I think, 16 sunrises and sunsets a day. But obviously, they've turned the lights down. This is the what's often referred to as the veggie experiment. So it's a special grow light, and they can adjust the color temperature of the light. Right now they're growing lettuce in here, which I believe they may have eaten some of on that mission as well.
Yeah, they did, yep.
And you're looking back, so this is the Columbus module. So this is out, at the, if you will, the bow of the space station. and you're looking through node two. So the station is really a series of modules connected by nodes. So the modules have connectors at either end. The nodes have six connectors. So this is the Columbus or European module. This is node two, and then the Japanese or Kibo module is at the end. And they have their own small experimental airlock. The astronauts can't leave through their airlock, but the payloads can go out onto the porch, as they call it. And then you have the actual, what they call the Quest joint airlocks. This is the referred to as the Quest joint airlock, which is actually two airlocks. The outer part here is the equipment lock, and the rear part is the actual airlock where the astronauts exit the station to go on spacewalks. And you see they have the suits stored in here. It looks like there are two, but there are really more. There's probably four suits on board, because you can see there's two boots there, there's a boot there, there's two boots there, so that's at least three sets of pants. And I think there may be some stuff stored back in there as well. Again, stuff is stored everywhere. They have to clear all that out to go on a spacewalk. So, and the spacewalks take a fair amount of preparation. They have to, I think, breathe nitrogen for, I'm not sure how long.
Yeah, they have to breathe in a normal atmosphere for 24 hours, okay. I believe, before.
So it's you know, when you watch the movie and they just jump into a spacesuit and go out, it doesn't really work like that. This image is of the EMU, and this is, which is basically an EVA or extravehicular activity suit. And this picture is the reflection of the opposite suit. And Paolo set up his camera on a little articulated arm here, and wisely got out of the way and put it on a timer, so you don't see Paolo in the picture. It's not a self-portrait of him. And people are often confused when they see the backwards numbers here on the front of the suit, because everything else is forwards if you look at the picture. But the astronauts can't see those controls. They can't tip their head forward. So they have mirrors on their wrist that they can look at the controls and adjust them. This, obviously, the mirror reads properly.
Roland, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Why did you decide not to have any crew in these images?
Because I did want to focus on the station itself, the spacecraft itself. There are so many photographs of the crew that, it was kind of a stretch to ask to get to do this project, so I felt like we had to do something that was going to be different and worthwhile, and more pictures of the crew. I do have a couple, somebody floating by way down the corridor, you know, way down the modules, but it was really about the station itself. And I also like to tell stories without people. I mean, I'm not going to say that it's easier to tell with people, but it's different. So if you can tell a story and get information across that has human things in it, like here on the astronaut food container. So these are their individual containers that can get special food. This one, Sabat says, Army of One, stomach of 10. Kaba says, Hardcore Peace Corps. I'm assuming he was in the Peace Corps. Now, leading me to conclude. So, I like the challenge of expressing an emotion, telling a story, without having the human element directly involved.
And that does humanize it, right? These are aspects of material culture that tell us that story, right? We I don't want to say we don't need them.
No.
But that's the kind of thing about archaeology and how it works, is that, you know, usually we're talking about people so far back we can't talk to them and ask them.
Right.
But even if you're talking to somebody now about why they did that, they might not want to tell you, or they might not be able to articulate it really well. But we could at least observe what it is. So like if we gave them a questionnaire and said, fill this out about your life on the space station, they wouldn't tell us about this.
Right.
This is what allows us to paint that richer picture using material culture, which you're documenting in these images.
Right.
It's fantastic.
Exactly.
And we can see the various displays. I think you had a story about the space shuttle here.
Yeah, I mean, so this struck me for a couple of reasons. You had talked about the plastic bags and Alice's term, which is surrogate gravity.
Gravity surrogates, yeah.
And so you'll notice that cables are, they're not just wrapped with a tie wrap, they're shoved in bags because they spring out. They just float out. So you have, you know, it's bad enough. It's chaotic enough. So these bags for that. This is a model that was taken up on one of the shuttles out of the, and it's signed by a number of people. John Casper, who was an astronaut. Mike Leinbach, who it was miscontrol. I'm not sure exactly what the other signatures are. And then also there's an eye chart up here in the corner, which is significant because when I was a, you know, when I was a kid and the Mercury, Gemini, Apollo missions were going off, I would have loved to have been an astronaut, but I got glasses in third grade, so back then you had to be a pilot, which meant you had to have perfect vision. Well now,
it's all changed. Astronauts,
they all wear glasses because when they get up on the space station, the shape of their eyes changes. Mm-hmm. And they have to prep them. So to me, this is the irony of my childhood that every astronaut wears glasses.
The display aspects, the visual display aspects, we see them again and again, right?
Yeah.
So we talk about that with that first image with the stickers and the memorial.
Yes, yeah.
We have this toy space shuttle, which is kind of a memorial to the space shuttle program. And then here in this last image, we have the European example of that. So you know, these have been American ones that we've seen mostly. But here we see the inside of the hatch in the European Columbus module, where they've done something similar. You know, they've got the mission patch stickers, some of which are signed. We've got a little medallion there. We've got a UN sticker. As presumably there was some kind of collaboration between the European Space Agency and the UN. But then really interestingly, we have an artwork that was produced by a major artist here on Earth, the French street artist Invader. You see his little mosaic tile pieces in cities all over the world, including in Los Angeles, and here in Orange County. I heard there's one down in Newport Beach. But here, he specially made this on commission for the European Space Agency. He decorated some of their campuses on Earth and set this up, and Samantha Cristoforetti placed this on the hatch. It's great. It's a little Invader that's actually in space, because it's on the space station, and it's looking at, you can see, little Earth there. And right next to it, I think this is fantastic, I'm pretty sure it was Paolo who did this, a geocaching tag. So if you're into geocaching, good luck to you if you want to try and get that particular tag, be the first to log it. I don't know how that's going to happen. But anyway, I wish you luck with that. So it's a terrific show that reveals so much about life for the crew and, you know, as an archaeologist. This is fascinating, especially somebody working on, like, how do people adapt to life in space? You know, how do they adapt to space habitats? This is not Star Trek, right? This is not, like, smooth surfaces and touch screens and stuff like that. All of this is very, very different.
It's chaotic. I mean,
yeah.
It's absolutely chaotic. So, I feel like we succeeded in the goal of documenting the interior at a single point in time, like any building anywhere. If it evolves over time. But in 2017, the fall and early winter of 2017, this is what the International Space Station looked like. So I'm very happy with the outcome.
And Roland, tell everybody how they can find your work online.
They can find my work at rolandmiller.com, and abandonedinplace.com is actually another way that refers to my first body of work on the abandoned space launch complexes. And the book for this will be available in about a week.
Right when the show is open.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. So just a fabulous documentation, but also like the artistic approach that you and Paolo took together.
Yeah.
To this site, you know, which has been it's so significant in the history of space flight
And I was very lucky that Paolo himself is an excellent photographer. I mean, fantastic photographer. His photograph for One Strange Rock has photographed a lot of the, if you have an Apple TV, a lot of the screensaver shots from space are the things he shot. But to me, one of the neat things about it is we believe it's the first time that an artist on Earth and an astronaut have collaborated, certainly at this level. So it's really kind of a groundbreaking project in regards to that, and that was a fun aspect of it. Plus, it's the International Space Station. Paolo's Italian, I'm American, so it was an international collaboration on the International Space Station.
And hopefully it shows, you know, that this is a place where culture happens. Right? Culture is made, that you're producing culture by producing these objects, but it's also just by virtue of the fact that the astronauts are there. They're making their own culture in space. So exciting.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for allowing us to be the first place to see and show these images.
Thank you for hosting.
Hopefully some of the public will get to see it at some point. We're not sure, but in any case, here it is installed.